Addictive, so new and so addictive, you will want it no other way.
Welcome to Bloomberg Quint and to this special interview with Finance Secretary Hasmukh Adia. It's been a day since the presentation of the government's Union Budget 2018. In that one day, the markets have not given it necessarily the best of receptions. We've also seen an impact in the bond markets. There also seems to be some degree of confusion regarding the central theme about this year's budget. So let's put all of those questions to Mr. Adia, who has been a critical man and strategist in devising this budget in the finance ministry. Mr. Adia, good afternoon. Thank you for joining us here on Bloomberg Quint. Let me start by asking you about the immediate events of the last few hours, which is how the equity markets seem to have reacted in the day after the budget. And it hasn't been a welcome of any sorts. In fact, today we've sold off the most since last we sold off after the demonetization exercise. What do you think about the budget has displeased the market so much, besides the return of long-term capital gains tax?
Well, it's because of that one provision that the market was expected to react, and we had expected some amount of correction in the market because of that extra tax of 10% we have put on the long-term capital gain tax.
Okay, fine. Okay, that's a quick brief answer. You've nailed it to the LTCG problem. I'm going to come back to that. I have some questions around that. But I also do want to ask about your government's position or stance towards the bond market, sir, because over the last several weeks, we've seen a hardening of yields on account of certain government announcements or actions. We saw that happen yesterday as well. Are you not fearful of what kind of positioning that sort of implies on the interest rate environment in the country at a time when the government for several months has been telling the RBI they should have been softening its stance, is now the primary reason why we've seen yields harden?
Well, it's also hardening the bond rates because of the liquidity in the market. There is some sort of a lack of liquidity in the market. That's one reason. And second also is that because of the announcement of extra fiscal borrowing, which we have done 0.3% in the yesterday's budget, some amount of hardening of bond rate was expected.
But do you not believe that these government moves are counterproductive to your own efforts to keep rates lower, keep inflation lower?
Well, there are certain things which we cannot help. I mean, if we had to bite the bullet, we have to bite the bullets. So instead of fudging the figures, we have frankly told the market that, yes, we are exceeding our fiscal deficit target by 0.3 this year, and next year we are giving it a target of 3.3. So that's what we have to do, you know.
Okay. In trying to understand what the central theme of the Union Budget is, I will place before you some commentary that we've received from a variety of market experts, and you tell me which one of them actually is most closely aligned to the message that the Finance Ministry would like to send out. For instance, earlier this morning, we were speaking to Ridhim Desai of Morgan Stanley. He seemed to think that the central message of this budget was inflation control, because he said that everything that you were attempting to do as a government was to try and keep inflation under check, and it was only the MSP issue that could potentially increase food inflation towards the end of the year. Many people disagree with that approach and think that in fact this budget seems to have both underestimated the expenditure required for next year and maybe even underestimated the revenue required for next year. Or what would you say is the central theme of this budget?
Well, our central theme is to provide for whatever funds are necessary for rural rejuvenation and not be miser in that. So we have done that. We have made some provisions for rural sector, for agriculture, for social security, for health and education. Now, these are very important sectors for which we have to provide. According to me, the estimates of expenditure are very, very realistic. There is absolutely no underestimation there. But when it comes to revenue, I would like to agree with the tax experts that yes, we can expect much better tax buoyancy next year because of GST compliance also going up, and also because of the effect of demonetization, all the tax notices which have gone to people who have deposited money, that will ultimately result into assessment orders, penalty, then again it will go to appeal. So the recovery of those extra taxes will continue for next 2 to 3 years. So we can expect a much better direct tax growth rate next year and also the indirect tax growth rate.
In which case, Mr. Adia, what explains your estimates of growth in the budget? Because, you know, there does seem to be, a group of people who believe within the markets that these are lower than what the government can achieve. For instance, I think you've projected an 11% increase in GST revenue, if you take all the adjustments into account, which could be definitely a higher number if we are to see growth recovery this year and if we are to see a smoothening in the GST implementation, more compliance, etc., etc. So are you just simply being conservative, or are you anticipating maybe some hurdles, in the process of rolling out GST even further that has led you to be more conservative?
Well, always the finance men should be very conservative in estimating revenue, but one should be very realistic in estimating the expenditure. So that's exactly what we have done. Our expectation is that yes, with GST compliance going up, we will get much better revenue. But we have to be erring on the side of caution when it comes to revenue. And that's why we have put a reasonable estimate there rather than a very buoyant estimate. But we do hope that it will be much better than this.
So can you quantify much better for me? What is the leeway you have given yourself in, let's say, percentage point terms?
In fact, there is no limit to expectation.
Yeah, there's no limit to expectation, but I think, if you're admitting that you've been conservative both in projecting GST revenue and in direct tax revenue.
Why hazard a number?
Would it be fair to say you've been at least 2 to 3%?
I don't want to hazard any number on this.
Okay. But you've put in numbers that are at least 2 to 3% lower than what you're
expecting. Number to it. No, we can't put any number to that. Our expectation is it will be much better. Now, I can't tell you what it will be,
Okay.
It's only a hazarding a guess.
Okay. On the expenditure side, when it comes to, fuel subsidies.
Expectation may be so high that if I state,
Please go ahead, sir.
Menka, my expectation may be so high that if I put that number before you, will not even believe it.
Okay, fine. All right. Then I'll just wait for the year-end achievement numbers. Next year, same time, we'll be able to match notes. I wanted to talk about the expenditure side. And, I won't get into each different vertical of expenditure. But I do want to ask one question as a clarification question. And this is, what is the price of crude you have assumed when providing for the fuel subsidy number? That is the one thing that left us all perplexed. We were not sure what price of crude you have benchmarked it to. Because you would have had to benchmark it to some number, saying at this price of crude, this is my subsidy bill. That is something that we were not sure of.
We have taken the current level, nothing more than that.
The current level would mean roughly between 60 to 65, 65 to 70?
Yeah, whatever is the current level, yeah.
Okay. Okay, 60 to 65, 65 to 70. You spoke of, additional spend in rural India. And I think the one big idea in this budget is what Finance Minister Arun Jaitley called Modi Care, which is the national health cover scheme, so to speak, or the health insurance scheme, so to speak, or Ayushman, as it's been branded in the budget. It definitely is, by all standards, an ambitious scheme, an ambitious effort to provide better health coverage across India. But the question I must ask you, sir, is while it's been welcomed across the board by industry, by individuals, by markets as an idea and a concept, you've backed it up in the budget simply by a 2,000 crore rupee spend. Why is that?
That is because the scheme has to be operationalized, and The contours of the scheme have to be worked out by the health ministry sitting with the state governments. That is number one. After that, the entire process of empanelment of hospitals, and after empaneling hospitals, we have to go in for either an insurance model in which price discovery will have to be done for the premium amount. And then, so you have to decide the qualification criteria for hospitals, for insurance companies to bid, and after that the price discovery will happen. So it'll take 6 to 8 months for scheme to be operationalized. That is our expectation. So whatever is the remaining month for which some amount has been provided, actual estimates are already there with Niti Aayog. And Niti Aayog would give you better idea of how much expenditure. Because they expect that when such large group of people is insured, the premium rates come down very significantly. So you can't start calculating ki on a single mediclaim, family floater of 5 people, how much is the premium and how much will it be for the entire country. Because here the large group is being covered. So in a group insurance, the premium amount comes very low. And so they would have done some calculation, but ultimately it will depend on whatever is the price discovery in the insurance sector. And then whatever it comes to, the government is committed to funding it.
I understand that, sir, and I'm not hazarding a guess on what your spends would likely be. I'm just making sure that we all understand what the contours of this scheme will be and what you're, how you're, you know, hoping to be able to implement it through the course of the year. So this definitely will be, because, you know, I think some banners on social media yesterday suggested this is a medical reimbursement scheme. This is a scheme in which you take over the premium burden of health insurance for 10 crore families in the country. Is that a fair way to understand it?
Yeah, that's a fair way, but instead of necessarily giving a price discovery, will have to happen like that only. But after that, instead of giving it to insurance companies, some states may prefer to roll it out in a trust model also. Both these models are available. And there are some states which are having their health insurance scheme, medical insurance scheme, which is in trust model, while there are other states where it is in insurance model also.
Okay. And will states be sharing some cost of this as the rollout of this, you know, sort of expands over time?
Yeah, it's a centrally sponsored scheme. I presume since it's a centrally sponsored scheme, it'll be 60-40.
It'll be 60-40. And so the 2,000 crores really only just provides for the very initial start of the scheme. It does not provide for anything substantive in the scheme. And you think that the larger expenditure of the scheme will fall in the next financial year, which is 2019-20, more than in 2018-19?
Next year.
Okay, all right. A couple of quick questions. I know you're short of time and you're very, very busy. I do want to ask you a couple of questions on tax.
No, I think you must wind up now, Menaka.
I'll put in a couple of important questions, sir, to you.
Yeah.
One has to do with the fact that, you know, Finance Minister Arun Jaitley in 2015.
Please ask me one last question. Please ask me one last question.
Okay. Can I make it a several part question?
Last question. That's
okay.
It.
On tax, I had two or three, parts to it.
No, only one part, one question.
Have you ruled out a corporate tax rate cut for large businesses?
Please.
Have you ruled out a corporate tax rate cut for large businesses from 30% to 25%? It was a promise made in 2015.
We don't want to hazard a guess for future. That's a question you can ask Mr. Jaitley, you know. But we can never predict the future. We are only talking about what we have announced in the budget so far.
Okay. And sir, will you consider doing away with STT now that LCCG is back?
Thank you very much.
All right. There we have it.
No, it only when the... okay.
No, sir,
so
please do finish.
We'll discuss it some other time, okay?
Please do finish. If you can answer the question, it would be great. Do you intend to do away with STT now that LTCG is back?
STT, we have already said it will stay till such time as the capital gain regime for equity market remains subsidized, because it's already a easy regime for them compared to all other classes of investment. So long as we have a 15% short-term capital gain instead of 30%, so long as we have got a 10% long-term capital gain instead of 20%, and so long as we have got only 1 year period for long-term capital gain instead of 2 years, which is the case in case of other assets, this STT will continue.
Can I put in a quick question on divestment, sir, since you would have architected some part of that policy? All right. It looks like we've run all out of time with Hasmukh Adia. He has a busy day. But I think the key takeaway from this interview is the finance secretary saying, yes, we have been conservative when it comes to revenue targets, and that it's better for finance people to be conservative than put all their cards on the table. So it does seem to confirm, I think, some of the conversations we've had through the day here on Bloomberg Quint, that maybe the government will be able to achieve a better direct tax collection as well as GST collection by the end of FY19. But that really is a long time away right now. Thanks very much for tuning into this interview, and thank you for being on Bloomberg Quint.